Everybody, Brandon Hayez with the Next Up Show. This is the cream. What's going on, everybody? I'm Brandon Hayez. I'm here with the Next Up Show. This is my segment, The Cream. Today I'm going to be talking about youth athletics, but actually diving into the wrestling and Brazilian jiu-jitsu side of it. What I'm going to be talking about is parents, coaches, and the athlete side of it. With that being said, I have been involved in the grappling industry since of the age of 15. I was extremely lucky. As soon as I started wrestling, I was able to dive into the coaching side, and I've been able to really enjoy the path of being an athlete and also a coach. And with that, I've been involved with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu since 2007. And with that being said, I want you guys to go ahead and check out this music video before I go diving into this subject. This is Ses Crew, Seven Chakras. I hope you guys enjoy.
Tips, it's a good night, no long kiss. Since 13, I've been clocked in. Since playground, I've been on point. Since capture enemy, I weighed in like an iron giant with a strong voice. Since matter no money, you could pay me 1979 when it made me. Now I change ways, trying to stay sane in these fast times and these strange days.
Here I go, fired up, glow same color as a fire truck. Last dragon on bath salts, up in the way, I'm high as fuck. In the pocket, I'm popping off, pinpoint but not proper. Stealing energy from my enemies, taking in through my chakras. Steal verses, build curses, every now and I feel worthless, walking around in the presence of greatness. Why would a nigga not feel nervous? Yes, we gotta build purpose and rep the mitigate, it feels worth it. Came in the game with a ball and a chain and the damn thing changed. I'm still working, still lurking, still purping, chonging out when I'm in the booth and my team is up to par. Y'all can hit the bar, I ain't lying to my shit's the proof. No capsizing when I'm flowing, these waves don't play fair. I wade through my night dreams, backstroke through my daymares. They don't care, I don't either, still rocking that white pleaser. It's Ses Crew and we clicked up, so we roll with no leader. I'm in the mood to the repeater, I'm in a gunfight packing the cleaver. And in the moment, my opponent better feel me like I was rapping the ether.
I ask for truth, you act aloof. I say some things to get back to you. Life's 10% what happens to you. Other 90%'s all attitude. I'm shatterproof, built strong enough to maintain my will.
Hey, hope everybody enjoyed that video from Ses Crew, Seven Chakras. Hey, I'm going to go ahead and get into the parent side of youth sports, wrestling, and jiu-jitsu. Yes, I am a parent. Yes, my son will be involved in wrestling and jiu-jitsu. Will I be a parent that will use my advice that I'm going to give you? Yes. Will it be trying to stay perfect in that? Of course. So let me get started. As a parent, you have got to have fun. If you're having fun, your child is going to feed off of that. If you don't focus on winning and losing, and it's about them going out and having fun and getting better each time that they get on the mat, this is in practice and also in competition, you're gonna teach your child, one, how to deal with winning and losing. We're seeing a lot of videos nowadays where kids are doing these elaborate celebrations, they're showing up their opponent, or they're out throwing a fit on the mat. Well, with that right there, I've got to go back to the advice of Kevin Klim to my parents when me and my brother were younger. He told my parents, win or lose, and this was more towards my brother, win or lose, you've got to have a smile when he comes off the mat. And the reason with that, if he goes out there, your child goes out there and gives it their all, that's all you can want as a parent. There's nothing else. Yes, they're winning. It makes everything better. But you've got to understand, man, they're doing these sports to set them up later in life. And, you know, it's kind of one of those where the human race is we learn by failure, by losing. And I can tell you right now, I know that my mom had problems when I first started wrestling because I was going against kids that, because I started wrestling in high school, I was going against kids that were sophomores, juniors, that had been wrestling for years. And my mom couldn't understand and went to one of my coaches and asked, you know, why is Brandon having to wrestle these kids that have all these this more experience? And Quentin Hammontree was the coach, and he said, Miss Hayes, Brandon's on JV, and at JV, he is going against kids that could not make the varsity lineup, and that kids that could be freshmen, but they could be sophomores or juniors. And with that being said, my mom wrapped her head around it, and it was like, well, hell, Brandon's just got to go out there, and he's got to deal with it. Throw him to the wolves then. And with that being said, you know, I was an aggressive kid. My brother was an aggressive kid. With that, you know, I'm going to get more into now reasonable goals. You know, my brother was extremely talented from day one that he got on the wrestling mat. Very aggressive, very strong kid, very active, always moving. And wrestling was a great balance for him because he was able to go out and, you know, learn how to wrestle and grab a hold of people and positioning and everything like that. And, you know, but over time, we did not have the reasonable goals about Brett learning the sport, learning how to win, learning how to lose. And the older that he got and the closer he got to high school, my brother really, it wasn't fair to him how me and my parents were, it was all about winning with him. And that being said right there, you know, that's reasonable goals. I'm going to have to get in real quick about the appropriate behaviors, a video that came out about with two moms talking trash, a dad or coach jumps up, attacks one mom. I'm going to tell you guys right now, I've seen the worst of the worst. We had one year down at Tulsa, we had a dad actually get arrested for abuse. He smacked his kid coming off the mat. And this kid, very talented kid, multiple time state champ, wrestled in college and everything like that. Dad's kid, we lost a really tough first round match. Kid walks off the mat and dad smacks him. Dad runs off, the sheriffs come to me, and I'm like, hey, it was the dad, you know, and I've taken the kid, consoling him, and, you know, it was like, hey, you know, talking him down, and the kid was used to it. The dad was very inappropriate in his behavior, and later in the tournament, he ended up getting arrested because he was beating on the kid in the restroom later because the kid didn't place. And to me, that right there is inappropriate behavior. Man, you guys got to be appropriate. You got to go back to the rules. Have fun, and win or lose, always have a smile. Your child's going out there to do their best. Another advice. All right, coaching aspect of this. You know, I've already brought up the whole dad coaching thing, why I don't want to be a coach. Here's my advice to the dad coaches out there. You cross that line, it's hard to go back over it with a child. You've got to understand that you cannot lose your cool. You can't take it personal, and you've got to stay positive with your own child and stuff. With that being said, I can't go into depth with that. I just don't have the time to do it. I'm on a time crunch. So coaches, here I go. Number one, man, you got to keep your cool. Practice time. Yeah, that's the grind time. You've got to push the kids. You've got to get it to. It's a fine line to walk. And I never really thought about this, but there's a line that you cross to where it starts turning towards the abuse side. And if you don't get close to that line, it's not neglect, but you are not giving the kids the full opportunity as a coach. So one, don't ever let your emotions take over to where you make an ass of yourself. Trust me, I have done it before, and you know, it's one of those, you lose some of the kids, and you lose the respect of them. You know, one thing I will say, on the coaching side of it, I really do not allow parents to be in the practice room unless they are out there helping me coach. And on the rules side of that, they're not allowed to coach their own child in the practice room. They have to be working with everybody else's child, because the other dad coaches that are in there are going to be rotating, working with your child and all the other children in there, and not their own child. And the reason why you do that, it keeps away from the dad being the villain if his child is acting up. And with that right there, I've had instances where we've had kids act up in practice, and then all of a sudden it turns around that, oh, the coaches are picking on me. Well, the kid was completely screwing off in practice, and you know, it got to the standpoint where the parents jumped on board, and we did my special ed background, we did a behavior plan and everything, and it just became a complete nightmare. And you know, one thing that I learned out in Colorado coaching with Austin Navu, which is Colorado School of Mines coach I've known for many years, when we started Stud Farm out there, he brought a code of conduct contract, and you know, it worked wonders out there. And then when we came back to Kansas City, you know, the first club I worked at, it wasn't my club. I was just a coach there, and they had their own way because of the gym, how they were running their gym. But the second club I went over to coach, you know, the club had not had too much success, and they asked me to come in. I had already been asked by my high school coach, and you know, I saw some headaches there. And when I came in, you know, I started laying down the foundation for the club. And I always kept getting, pullback from the director that, you know, one, a code of conduct contract wouldn't work, you know, it blah, blah, blah. There was always excuses with it. But the dad coaches were all for it. We couldn't do it because the director wouldn't let us. And, you know, code of conduct is going to set up success with the foundation of rules that you put in there. And then it's also going to make it to where the kids and the parents plus the coaches are being held responsible for actions and the way that they act and practice in the classroom, and then also in tournament situations. And you know, with that right there, you know, I walked away from that situation, and it was hard to, but it was better for everybody. You know, on the coaching side of jiu-jitsu, you know, coaching with Jason Bircher over at KCBJJ has been, you know, it's a great opportunity, and you know, I can't wait to get back to it. I know Erica's excited. And, you know, he's got a great coaching staff over there. Travis Mott and Jerome, you know, have done a great job. And, you know, Jerome's a college wrestler that, dude, he's a big teddy bear. But, man, you know, he's shining over there as a coach. So then I got to go over the clear goals. You got to have a umbrella, goals for the entire club or the entire gym for the kids. But then you kind of want to do individual goals for each kid, and you've got to have individual goals for each kid, but you've got to also, as a coach, teach those kids how to set up goals for their journey through grappling, wrestling, or jiu-jitsu, or you got a lot of kids that are starting to do both, and man, that's scary right there. I look at it this way. One thing that I take pride in, every time I get on the mat and coach, I learn from the kids. I learn from other coaches. And, you know, from that right there, that is a major thing as a coach. You've got to evolve. You have to go in wanting to learn every day. One thing, examples I'm going to use, you know, Jeff Glover did a Instagram post talking about Nicky Ryan out of Henzo Gracie's John Donaher Death Squad. He's a 17-year-old that just won the ADCC West Coast Trials. 2 years ago, he got invited because somebody got injured to go down to Brazil and compete. And then he also, Glover brought up, I think it was Cade Rotolo, one of the twins out of AOJ. Man, you look at it that right there. Those kids are coming from unbelievable coaching and everything. And it's systems. I mean, they've got in. If you know Donaher, he's got a leg system. The Mendez, they've got their system. Gaval's got his system. So as parents, you've got to really kind of focus on where can you get the best coaching, best environment and everything.
The surface, got a new lens. I got a lot of family but few friends. I know this cliche shit to say, but reality rap is a challenge, cause facts are facts and can't go many different ways. Fuck it, here we are. It ain't guaranteed that you'll be here tomorrow. You live life like you got an extra day to do shit, and you'll die and I'll leave here. It's hard, so do it all today. Or in 20 years, you're gonna look at life like you threw it all away. Ain't no guarantees, but I guarantee if you have a little veggies and some juice, you'll calm your day. I don't wanna lie to you for the fame or the money. Maybe I could write the truth along the way. I've had writer's block to this beat for a full year. Fuck it, I'ma do this song today. Yup, gonna finish it and love it. Then I mix it, then I dub it, then I ship it to the public. If I dissing it, then fuck it. Doesn't matter my opinion as I'm ripping it and crushing it. The dissing it's a fucking sick. All the critics, I can suck a dick. Every single fucking day, I'm getting up at 6. Then I feed my kids and I hit this studio. Then I spew flow so beautiful, you should know.
The universe is expanding. Gotta give a fuck, I'm drinking all day. All the dreams I have are in color. Even though my memories are all gray. And the whole damn world is burning. But you never know because you're too busy staring at your phone. Only way that I can feel happiness is when I'm by myself standing.
Yo, that was Mac Lethal with the Casket Drops. I'm going to get into the athlete side real quick and then shut out this video for everybody. Hey, as an athlete, youth athlete, all the way up into your teens and then and actually into the adult side of it, have fun. That's it. Just have fun. Learn at all costs and have from the very beginning, because a lot of people don't get to start at a young age. They start, you know, as a teenager, you know, and then, you know, as in the jiu-jitsu world, shit, there you've got people that are starting in their 30s, their 20s, their 40s, their 50s. You know, build a work ethic. Go out and train hard. You know, do those little extras. And you know, it's kind of one of those, I've been extremely lucky to work with some amazing athletes, some national champs, some four-time state champs, some kids that are two-time state champs, one-time placed, some of them fell short, did not, but, you know, unbelievable athletes. And you know, as an athlete, you got to set goals. You've got to hold yourself to a bar that might feel sometimes it could be just out of reach, but man, that's going to make you want to work that much harder to get there. And you know, as an athlete, you know, I learned very young in my wrestling career, and I was 15 years old, man, you can't give up. And you know, I went to a tournament. It used to be one of the bigger JV tournaments. I went out. I ran into the first seed, first match. I'm getting throttled, 13-0. There's 20 seconds on the clock. I hit a Peterson, throw him on his back. I pin him with 3 seconds left. I turn around. I come out. And I place third at the tournament. Then I turn around, I go see the kid 2 weeks later. Same thing, I'm getting throttled again. Turn around, hit a Peterson, put him on his back, pin him with a little bit of time left. That's one thing that I learned that, man, right off the bat, you're never out of a match. And with jiu-jitsu and everything, man, you're never out. Wrestling, you're never out because you can pin a kid. You can hit a submission on a kid in jiu-jitsu. So what I'm going to tell you right now, when you're in the practice room, work your tail off. Push yourself to the limit. Your brain is going to tell you that you cannot do it. Well, guess what? Yes, you can, and you can go much further. You've got to break through those walls in practice to set you up for success in the matches. Other than that, another, learn at all costs. Take every situation and take a learning lesson from it. And then in the practice room, you've got to try to perfect your craft. And they say to get the basic mechanics, it takes about 1,000 reps. To get close to mastering, it takes close to 10,000 reps. Everybody's different on that, and some people it's going to take more. But don't ever say that you can't do it either. That's one rule that I've always put in my practices. You're not allowed to say I can't. Man, you owe me push-ups if you say I can't. Because that is the first step to giving up, is saying I can't do it. Say that I will do it. I will work towards doing it. And then guess what? It's the greatest feeling in the world when you do it. And, you know, it's kind of one of those that it's a great feeling. And I've got to cut this video a little short, but on top of it, I just want to say thank you to everybody that's watched this video. Please, if you have any comments, concerns, questions, get a hold of us at the Next Up Show. They'll get that to me. Other than that, this has been The Cream. Get out there and train. That's it. Parents, be happy. Coaches, be motivators. Other than that, everybody have a great night.
Ay, I'm all about my business, you unimportant girl. Ay, ay, trust me, baby, man, I be on my shit. I asked her where is she from, and she told me that she Dominican. With a fat, ay, got a fast, ay. Remember back up in the days I was a bass, yeah. Ay, ay, now I be fucking with these foreign hoes, yeah. Ginger, but baby, I'm with the committee, you know I go, yeah. Ay, all I wanna do is take some trips. Met a bad bitch, she said she from Egypt.
She from Africa.
Met a bad bitch and she came straight from France.